But let me give you a little bit of instructions on what we are to expect this morning. Mike will be sharing for about 30, 35 minutes in the sermon. And then after that, we'll be open for question and answer, Q&A. During the Q&A, we would like you to raise your hands. All right, as you raise your hands, then the mics will be distributed. And please speak into the mic because he can't hear you if you speak just as you are. He needs to hear you through the mic so that the voice will be transported to America. So those are very simple logistics. So you do need to raise your hands so we get it to you. And if you do have questions, please do write them down so that you don't forget them. And if we can't address them in this session, we will like you to do send us your questions so that we can send it to Mike and he may be able to answer us on a different occasion. For those sitting on the side, it is recommended that you do sit inside. All right? Do sit inside. Yeah, please do. All right. Mike will only have this view right here, right in front of me. All right? So if you're right in front of me, do give him a good wave right now. All right? Just wave. Awesome. Good. There you go. Why don't we open with a word of prayer and I'll pass it on to our brother Zhang. Let's pray. Father, I want to come before you. We come before you. Knowing that you are the God who desires to communicate with us. You desire to show yourself and reveal yourself to mankind. And we pray, Lord God, that this morning as we get into the Word, as we understand what your Word means and what it means for us today, open our hearts, open our minds to receive from you what the Holy Spirit is preparing already for each of us. Come, Holy Spirit, and bless each of us here. We pray for Mike, Lord God, that you will anoint him, prepare him, Lord God, as he speak your word. And thank you, Lord God, for such an amazing opportunity to interact with him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to welcome Joshua Zhang to do a bit more for us. Let's welcome him.
Morning, Mike. Can you hear me?
Good morning, Zhang.
Wait, let's just adjust your volume a bit. Can you try that again?
Yes, good morning from America.
Much better. Okay, I'm going to show you our congregation for a bit. Let me just spin this computer. Okay. What is? That's everyone. Okay, I'm just going to do a bit of introduction about Mike. So Mike is from the U.S., as Reverend Stephen has said. He's born in Maryland. He became a Christian at age 10. He grew up in a Christian home. He attended Liberty University, where he earned a bachelor degree in music performance in a saxophone. And this is not stated in his website, but I also learned that from one of his videos that he does taekwondo for many years. So during his undergraduate studies, he had a strong desire to know God. He decided to learn Koine Greek in order to read the New Testament. He later completed a master's degree in religious studies. Towards the end of his graduate work in 1995, he began to question his faith. And he wondered whether there's any evidence to support it. So he decided not to go into Christian ministry, and finding answers to his questions, it consumed him, and he almost jettisoned his faith. He investigated the evidence for Christianity and a number of major world religions. He also considered the arguments for atheism. His investigation solidified his faith that God exists and that God revealed himself to mankind in Jesus Christ, and that the Christian view provides the most plausible and unified theory of reality. Mike now has a website. It's called Risen Jesus. He has a YouTube channel as well. You can go to it. There's a lot of videos in there, a lot of resourceful information. He has a PhD in New Testament. He is an associate professor at the Houston Baptist University. And he has written a number of books, or co-authored a number of books, or was involved in the editorial in a number of books. And some of these books are, why are there differences in the Gospels? And what can we learn from ancient biography? The resurrection of Jesus And he wrote an award-winning book called The Case for Resurrection of Jesus with co-author Gary Habermas. So without further ado, I will give the floor to Mike. I connected with him back in August, I think, of 2020. It took a long time for us to get this date from Mike. He's very busy speaking in various campuses, university, churches. We again thank you, Mike, for opening up your schedule for St. Andrew's Church. I'll give the floor to you.
Well, thank you, Zhang. And thank you, Pastor Stephen, and the leadership of St. Andrew's Church. It is wonderful to spend a little time with you this morning. Even though we're so far apart in distance, it's wonderful what electronics can do. And we can talk to one another a lot live like this. This is wonderful. So it's wonderful to meet and to become acquainted with some of my brothers and sisters in Christ in Brunei. So thank you for inviting me. Well, I've been asked to speak on the historical reliability of the Gospels. So let me jump right into that. Oops, I need to share. Okay. All right. Can you all see this and hear it? Can you see and hear this?
Yeah. Yes, we can, Mike.
Okay,
loud,
great.
Loud and clear.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you. Okay. Set my clock here to make sure I don't go over time too. So let me do that. All right. So are the Gospels historically reliable? Well, before we can answer this question, we have to answer another question that is more fundamental. And that question is, what do we mean by the term historically reliable? Does it mean that the Gospels have to be without any error whatsoever? Is that what we mean by historically reliable? Well, if historically reliable means no errors, then that would, aside from the Gospels, we'd have to say that there's no literature that is historically reliable. Nothing about Julius Caesar or Alexander the Great or anything from antiquity. In fact, nothing from modern sources would be historically reliable if we're going to say you couldn't have any kind of errors whatsoever. Well, most people would not define historically reliable as without any errors at all. So how much would we allow to be an error? 1%? 2%? 5%? More than 5%? How much can be an error before we would say it's not historically reliable? And what kind of errors are we talking about? Would it be one large error, two large errors? What about one large error and 10 really small, insignificant details that would be errors? I think you can see that this is a difficult question and it's almost impossible to answer it. So let me make a suggestion. I think if we're going to define historically reliable, we should say that at the very minimum, it means that the document provides an accurate gist of what occurred. Now, I understand that when we say the word gist in English, there's a whole range of meaning that can be. So let me define it as it's historically reliable when it provides the main and essential parts that all of those are true. The main and essential parts are true. So I'm not saying that the Gospels are only reliable with the main and essential parts, but because I think they're more reliable than that. But I'm defining historically reliable. This would apply to the Gospels. It would apply to all ancient literature. That we can say it's historically reliable when the main and essential parts are true in it. All right. So in what follows today, I'm going to provide six reasons to think the Gospels are historically reliable. Now, I think we'll be able to get through most of these, but I have a video on my YouTube channel that goes through all six of these. So in case I don't get through all six, Zhang, I'll provide the link and Zhang can provide it to anyone who's interested. All right, reason number one. Do we have reasons to think that the authors of the Gospels intended to write an accurate account? I think we do, and let me provide several reasons why. For one, the Gospels are written in the biographical genre. They are ancient biographies. They aren't poetry. Okay, let me show you the characteristics of ancient biography. An ancient biography differs from modern biography, but let me show you the characteristics of ancient biography. Number one, in ancient biography, the focus is on the main character, not on an era, not on an event, not on a particular form of government. Now, that's the same way in modern biography, but that is one of the qualities or characteristics of ancient biography. In ancient biography, the goal was to mention the person's ancestry, their family, and then they skip ahead into the person's adult life. There's very little said about a main character's childhood in ancient biographies because they weren't interested in it. And that's why we don't really have much about many stories about Jesus when he was a child, because the Gospels are ancient biographies. They're not interested in that. All we have of Jesus as a child is one short story in Luke where Jesus and his family are in Jerusalem during Passover. And after Passover, his family leaves to go back to Nazareth. And they get a couple of days outside the city and they realize Jesus isn't with them. And so they go back to the city to find Jesus, and he's in the temple learning. And that's the only story we have of Jesus from his childhood. It launches right into his baptism and then his public ministry, because that's what biographies did back then. Number three, in ancient biography, the main subject's character is illuminated through their words and deeds. And this is a wonderful thing. We see this in the Gospels. I don't have time to get into it, but it's wonderful to see how the Gospels do shed light on Jesus's character, that he is the divine Son of God. And we see this through his words and deeds. Well, let me just give you a few. So in chapter one of the Gospel of Mark, and my sister in Christ read from the Gospel of Mark this morning. I think it was my sister who did that. And the chapter one, it starts off, as Isaiah the prophet said, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the Lord, make straight his paths." Well, you would think that it's Jesus that's making the way ready for God, but instead it's John the Baptist making the way for Jesus, which suggests that Jesus is God, because that's what Isaiah was referring to. Chapter 2, Jesus forgives a man's sins and then heals him so that this paralytic can walk. And the Jewish leaders there say, well, that's blasphemy because only God can forgive sins. That's right. In chapter 3, you have Jesus awakened during a storm and he calms the wind and the waves, something the Old Testament says God does. Chapter 4, Jesus is accused of Satan, casting out Satan when he exercises demons. And Jesus gives an illustration that if you want to rob a house that belongs to a very strong man, you have to bind the strong man before you can rob him of his goods. Well, Jesus, by saying that, is saying that Satan, the devil, is the strong man, and his exorcism shows that he has bound Satan and is plundering his kingdom of souls. But what human can bind Satan? Chapter 5, Jesus walks on water, something only God does. Chapter 6, he raises the dead, something the Old Testament says only God does. Now, I know some of the apostles and prophets raised people from the dead, but they always did so by praying to God, whereas Jesus raised people from the dead by his own power. So throughout the Gospel of Mark, we can see that he is providing through Jesus' words and deeds who Jesus is. He is God's uniquely divine son. Ancient biographies were generally of the same length, between 10,000 and 25,000 words. And when we look, all four Gospels fall within this range of words. These are the number of Greek words that I have listed here. The Gospels are not ancient novels, because ancient novels typically were romances in which two lovers overcame obstacles. The Gospels are not romances. Moreover, ancient novels almost always involved fictitious characters who lived in the distant past. The Gospels, on the other hand, have all real people like Caesar Augustus, Herod the Great, Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate, Caiaphas, John the Baptist, and many others. These people are all known to be historical characters, and Jesus, of course. Sometimes, on a rare occasion, an ancient novel would mention a historical person, a real person who had lived. But there isn't a single instance of an ancient novel in which the person, the real person, had lived within even a century of the time of writing. But yet when we come to the Gospels, most of the people who are mentioned in them were written or had lived within just a few decades of their writing. So the Gospels are not ancient novels, they're ancient biographies. Okay. Second, we want to look to see, do these biographies have the intention of writing historically? We go to the Gospel of Luke, and Luke says, "It seemed fitting for me as well, having investigated everything carefully from the beginning, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know for certain the things you have been taught." John says, "And the one who is testified, his testimony is true, and he knows he is telling the truth, so that you may also believe." So we can see that John and Luke are quite clear. They are writing with history in mind. The Gospel of Mark mentions how the soldiers forced a passerby to carry Jesus' cross. The passerby's name was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus, who was coming in from the country. Many scholars believe that the reason Mark says that Simon was the father of Alexander and Rufus, because they knew his readers knew Alexander and Rufus, and so they could know that Simon was their father. So this would link it to historical writing. We also believe that the authors of the Gospels intended to write an accurate account. There are contemporary competing portraits. They all agree with one another. So for example, you've got Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all written in the first century. Jesus lived in the first century, and they're writing within only a few decades after the life of Jesus. The next accounts that we have about Jesus, the Edgerton Papyrus, the Gospel of Thomas, the Gospel of Peter, the Gospel of Mary, they're all written in the second century. And then you have the Gospel of Philip written in the third century. And then you have what's called the secret Gospel of Mark. That's a forgery that was written in 1958. But all four Gospels, all of these biographies that were written in the first century, the same century in which Jesus lived, agree with one another. So I said I'd give you six reasons. Here's the second. Do the authors choose their sources judiciously? Now let's look at this. Mark, the Gospel of Mark, the ancient church fathers all say that Mark received his information from Peter. He learned what he reports from Peter, who was an eyewitness and who was the number one disciple of Jesus. That's a pretty good source. The Gospel of Luke, we know today that, Luke said he got his information from eyewitnesses and those who knew the eyewitnesses. Early church tradition also says he got his information from Paul. And today we know that Luke also used Mark as his primary source and supplemented it. And then you'll see that I have here that he used a source or may have used a source named Q. Now, I know that this might all sound strange. Well, why did these guys use sources? Well, Luke was not an eyewitness, and so he has to use other sources. Mark was not an eyewitness, so he used the source, Peter. And it was common to use sources back then. Well, what is Q? Well, I don't want to get too deeply into this because it would pull us off track. But a lot of times you'll see that Luke and the Gospel of Mark are almost verbatim, almost word for word. They're so similar. Other occasions, they're not. Well, when they are reporting the same story and it's almost word for word, most scholars believe, and I think for good reasons, that Luke was using Mark as a source there. But there are many occasions when Luke and Matthew are almost word for word, but what they're reporting is not in Mark. So they couldn't be using Mark there. So either Luke is using Matthew, or Matthew is using Luke, or both Matthew and Luke are using a source that we no longer have. And it shouldn't surprise us because Luke said that many had written accounts of Jesus. Many. But yet we only have Matthew and Mark writing before Luke. John wrote after Luke. So at that point, I would think the word many would mean more than two. And so Q is probably one of those sources that Luke was mentioning. Why is it called Q? Because the scholar that recognized that Matthew and Luke were probably using a common source for some of the material, he was German. And the German word for source is Quelle. So Q is just an abbreviation for Quelle, the German word for source. But either way, we're looking at Luke had some very good sources. He's not using hearsay. The Gospel of John, the early church says, was written by the disciple, John, the son of Zebedee, who was an eyewitness. And then Matthew, the early church says, was an eyewitness. We know that Matthew used Mark as one of his sources. And then you've got that Q thing again. Either he used Luke or he used a source that both he and Luke knew of, and at least one other. So these are pretty good sources that the Gospels authors are using. And so that passes the test. Number three, we want to ask, did the author use the sources responsibly? Now, it's really interesting. Plutarch is regarded as the greatest ancient biographer, and Josephus was a Jewish historian in the first century. Plutarch is writing at the end of the first century and at the beginning of the second century. Plutarch, we know some of his sources, so we can compare how Plutarch used his sources, and we know some of Josephus' sources because he mentions them. He even quotes scripture. But we see that when Josephus quotes scripture, the Old Testament, we can see how closely he does quote it. And what's interesting is we see that Matthew and Luke, when they quote Mark, they stay closer to Mark than Josephus even does to scripture. Number four, do the author or their sources, were they capable of recalling stories accurately? Now, this gets interesting. Plutarch, he wrote more than 60 biographies, of which 48 have survived. And for example, he tells us about the biography of Caesar, the biography of Cicero, the biography of Brutus, and the biography of Antony. These are all written within 140 years of these people's lives. And Plutarch did not have to engage in large-scale conjecturing because he said he had really good sources. But then he turns from those and he said, now I'm going to write about Theseus, the legendary founder of Greece, and a biography of Romulus. And I'll bet you can guess who he's the legendary founder of: Rome. And Plutarch is writing 800 to 1,000 years after Romulus and Theseus were allegedly alive. And when he writes, he says, look, I've just covered the biographies of Caesar, Cicero, and others, and I had good information for them. But when I go back so far into the past, like Romulus and Theseus, all I have are poets and myth. And so I can't write good, accurate history for them. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take the poetry and myths that were written about them, and I'm going to rewrite them to make it sound like history. But don't be under any illusions that I'm writing accurate history. That's because he had to have this large-scale conjecturing because he didn't have good sources for something that far removed in the past. But when it came to within 140 years, he had plenty of sources and could write accurately. Well, what about the Gospels? Oops. Well, I just quoted him on these, so now I can skip that. What about the Gospels? The Gospels were written within only 20 to 65 years of Jesus' death. And so there's no need for large-scale conjecture. And the eyewitnesses were still alive. There were plenty of sources that were available to them. I think about things that happened in Brunei just 20 years ago. Lots of eyewitnesses for those events are still around that if you wanted to write on them, you could consult the eyewitnesses. Even 65 years ago, still plenty of, let's see, that would be 1956. Some of you were alive in 1956 and before, and you know eyewitnesses who are still alive who knew of events during that time. Memory. Now, within recent years, some scholars have really started to cast doubt on memory. And we understand not everybody remembers accurately. Now, I remember that several years ago, I was in a doctor's office getting a checkup. And when I left, I was going through the waiting room and there was an old man in there and he was wearing a hat that had a B-29 airplane embroidered on the hat. And I walked out and I was thinking, wow, he probably flew on one of these bombers during World War II. Well, my wife and I love studying about World War II. And I just couldn't resist. So I went back in the office, in the doctor's office, and I went up to the old man and I said, sir, did you fly on a B-29 during World War II? And he said, I sure did, son. And I said, wow, you must have some interesting stories. And he said, I do. We were in the Pacific Theater, and we were stationed on an island, and I'll never forget the native women on that island. They smelled terribly. And here it was over 60 years later, and he was remembering even how the women on this island had a terrible odor about them. Remembering that so far later. Well, here in the United States, back in 2001, 20 years ago, there were planes that terrorists flew into buildings over here in the United States. And we call it 9/11. And those of us who were alive during that time, we remember it. We can even tell you what the weather was like on that day. But if I ask people in the United States who were alive during that time, well, what was the weather like on September 11th last year? They won't remember. Because see, we will remember something that happened 19 to 20 years earlier on a particular day. Why is that? Because we remember things better when they impact us emotionally. Now, I'm going to skip ahead a little bit, but this was, I'll do that. Now I got to skip ahead because I want to cover something here. This was about Vietnam and American soldiers fighting over there and how there was a combat reporter. And here it was more than 30 years later, and he still remembers things. And he says, you just can't forget some of these things that you've experienced. They will remain with you for the rest of your life. You will remember these things for the rest of your life. So I'm going to skip that. But I want to say this. I'm going to come back on now. I'm going to have to stop the sharing there and just kind of wrap up. So when it comes to Jesus, think about the things that he did, okay? I want you to imagine yourself being a disciple of Jesus. You're following him around. He had male disciples. He had women followers. So here you are. You're traveling around with Jesus in the first century. Do you think you'd remember some of these things when you saw him walk on water? You saw him raise the dead. You saw Jesus give sight to the blind. You saw him take people who were paralyzed and tell them to get up and walk, and they do. You saw him raise people from the dead. And then you saw Jesus crucified. And then you saw him later, a few days later, in perfect health, having been risen from the dead. Do you think you would remember those things decades later? Well, of course you would. And then think about Jesus' teachings. Now, you will probably forget a lot of what I said by the time you leave church this morning. And certainly by the time you go to bed tonight, you will forget most of what I said today. However, I'm going to say something to you now that I think you will remember for the next few years. You see, Jesus is not like someone who gets up and preaches one message one time. It's not like your pastors there, your priests, who get up and preach a sermon, and then the next week it's a new sermon. See, Jesus would preach the same things because he was going to different towns, a new town every day, sometimes a couple of towns a day. And so he could preach the same thing over and 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 over. And the disciples heard him speak all these times. And then he sent them out. He said, I want you to teach the same things. And perhaps you've heard that the best way to learn something is to teach it yourself. And so they remembered what Jesus taught, and they went out and taught the same things over and 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 over. And then they came back and they talked to Jesus, and he would say to them, hey, what you can do, you can watch me now. When I'm talking to a Roman, I can change the parable a little bit to make it more applicable to them and tell it differently than I would to a Jew. And so they see him do it. And then they go out and they preach more over and over and over and over the same things, and they can correct one another. And then Jesus dies and he rises from the dead and ascends to heaven. And now for the next several decades, they preach the same things again, over and over and over, and you get the idea. It's not as though the disciples only heard Jesus preach a message like the Sermon on the Mount once, and then they're trying to remember it 30 years later. Jesus, they probably heard him preach that message hundreds of times, And then they preached it hundreds of times, all the way up to the time when the Gospels were written. And so they would have been able to recall Jesus' teachings even years later. And of course, they would have remembered what he said. So we can see that the authors were writing biographies. We can see that they chose their sources well. We can see that all these different things that I presented tonight, and they could recall these things accurately. And I've only presented four of these reasons. We have two more that I could give, but I'm out of time. But we have good reasons to think that the Gospels are historically reliable. We can trust them. And that makes me excited, because the Gospels tell us that Jesus died for our sins and that he rose from the dead so that we can have eternal life. Now, why is that important? Well, both of my parents died. My mom died in 2013. My dad died in 2014. I know that I'm going to see them again because they were followers of Jesus. And because the Gospels are historically reliable, I know that Jesus rose from the dead. And that is my guarantee that I can have eternal life, that my parents have eternal life. And no matter how difficult life gets here on earth, I can look forward to heaven because Jesus rose from the dead. And I can know that because the Gospels are historically reliable. All right, I would love to take some questions from you.
Thank you, Mike. We'll just really enjoyed that presentation, Mike. So now I'll invite questions from the floor. If anyone has any questions, please raise your hands. Anyone have any questions? Okay, Reverend Johnny has a question.
Thank you for sharing. I just wonder how discovering this reliability changed the way you read the Bible. Because I'm assuming before that you read the Bible in a certain way. And after you did this study, how reliable the gospel is, how does that change the way you read the Bible, and how does that change your life in a day-to-day basis?
Well, that's a good question. Thank you, Reverend, for asking that. Before I got involved in academic work, when I read the Bible, I just read it and trusted that it is God's holy word. And I believed it by faith. I would just hold it and read it and say, this is what God's message is, and I believed it by faith. But then I would talk to a lot of people who weren't Christians, people who were atheists, people who were agnostics, people who had other religious beliefs. And they would say, well, why do you believe that? How do you know that what you believe is true? Just because you believe it doesn't mean it's true. And I thought, well, that's correct. It's not true because I believe it. Other religions have their holy books, and they believe those books are true, but it doesn't mean that they are true just simply because they believe it's true. So I wanted to know, do I have good historical reasons for believing the Bible? Do I have good historical reasons for thinking that Jesus rose from the dead? And so that's why I wanted to do a historical investigation to see if the evidence would confirm that the Gospels are historically reliable. And I found that they are. So when I'm reading the Bible, I still regard it as God's word. But my academic research has revealed that it's not just faith. I have good reasons for thinking, good historical reasons for thinking the Bible's true.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you for that. Is there any other questions? Yes. So we have Victor here. I will show you using my phone who Victor is.
Okay. Thank you, Mike. That was really inspiring. A lot of new stuff there. I'm an enthusiast of Norm or N.T. Wright. No doubt you're familiar with him.
Absolutely. He's a good scholar, great scholar.
Yes, absolutely. So he has recently given me more fuel to the fire for faith by saying that Jesus Christ, Christ is not his family name like Joseph Christ or Mary Christ. Christ is the Latin word for Messiah. And so when we appreciate Jesus as the Messiah, that is a hugely historical role. Goes back to the Old Testament, to the 39 books and so forth. So the question is, how important is it for us to appreciate the role of Jesus as the Messiah based on a huge amount of scripture? And if I can ask just one more. There are those who are confused about the difference between the Septuagint and the Masoretic text. And this can lead them to, from confusion to perhaps giving up the faith because of some questions people ask regarding this. Is our faith based on something more important than the difference between those two traditions of scripture?
Those are good questions. Let me answer the first. You are absolutely correct that Jesus Christ, that is not his first name and his last name. Christ comes, it's the Greek word Christos, which is the how the Greeks translated from Mashiach, Messiah, and meaning Messiah, the anointed one. And yes, they believe that the early Christians believed that Jesus was the Messiah, the anointed one of God. So we can see that when Paul refers to Jesus as Jesus Christ or just Christ, that he was known as the Messiah from a very, very early time. This isn't a title that was given to him later on after his death. Now, in terms of the Septuagint, you are correct that sometimes the Septuagint, the Greek translation of the Old Testament, differs from the Masoretic or Hebrew text of the Old Testament. So what are we to do about this? Well, that's a really good question. What we do know is when the New Testament authors quote the Old Testament, and they do so, they either quote or allude to it more than 300 times. On more than half of those occasions, they are appealing to the Septuagint, the Greek translation, rather than the Hebrew the Hebrew Bible. And they didn't see a problem with that. And they are writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So what I would say in answer to your question is, God worked through the biblical New Testament authors in a manner that allowed them to use the Septuagint to make the point. And if God didn't make a big deal out of the Septuagint versus the Hebrew, we shouldn't make a big deal over many translations. So I think that I don't know what it's like over there in Brunei, but over in the United States, here in the US, we have a lot of English translations, and sometimes Christians can get in very heated debates over which translation one should use and which one they shouldn't. And I just tell Christians here, the only one they should not use is the New World Translation, which is by the Jehovah's Witnesses, and it's a very bad translation. But the rest of them, there's no perfect English translations, but most of them are very good.
Thank you, Mike. I'd like to invite other people for questions. Anybody else has any questions? Maybe I'll put a question to you, Mike. How about Old Testament reliability? Because here we're talking about the gospel reliability, right?
Yeah, well, that Zhang, that's something I can't comment on because it's not been an area of study for me. I focus exclusively on the New Testament. The Old Testament's important, but the Old Testament's important. I just I only have so much time, and I won't even finish studying the New Testament by the time I die. One lifetime isn't even nearly enough.
Okay, thank you, Mike, for that brief answer. Does anyone else have other questions? Mike, perhaps you could explain, because you were mentioning early church fathers. How important are the early church fathers to our understanding on the reliability of the Gospels? And also, I know that there are some discussions as to who was the real author of the Gospels, whether it's really John or is it someone else?
Oh, well, that's a good question, Zhang. Well, the early church fathers do provide us with some very valuable information, like pertaining to the authors of the Gospels. Our earliest manuscripts of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John don't contain any titles. Now, that shouldn't bother us, because there were nearly 100 biographies written within that 300-year period which Jesus had lived. So 150 years before Jesus to 150 years after, about 300 years of all these different biographies written about different people. And of those, only one of them, only one, contains the title. It's by Lucian of Samosata and his Passing of Peregrinus, written around the middle of the second century. All the rest of them don't have titles. So we believe the Gospels were written by Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John because the early church fathers tell us that they wrote them. And there are no real competing views that come from the early church or the earlier years after the Gospels were written. And the same thing applies to Plutarch's lives and Suetonius's lives of the 12 Caesars. It's not until later that you get people testifying of who wrote those, and classical scholars put together arguments and they say, well, these are probably the real authors. And we do the same thing with the Gospels. So we can't prove it with complete certainty, but it does seem that we have good reasons for thinking that the Gospels were written by the traditional authors.
That's one last question. You mentioned of the inspiration of the Holy Spirit in the writing of the Bible. Could you tell us a bit more of what that actually means? I mean, I'm assuming God works through people, but could you tell us a bit more? Help us understand your thoughts, what you mean by that. And therefore, if it's inspired by the Holy Spirit, how should we, the day-to-day Christian, read the Bible daily? Should we read it in specific or certain ways? What is your recommendation? If I am listening to you live, I want to read the Bible better. How should I read the Bible better then? Thank you.
Those are excellent questions. Much better than the one Zhang asked. Justine Zhang. All right, so this is a complicated issue. And the reason being is because the Bible never tells us about the process of divine inspiration. It doesn't tell us the mechanism that God used to do it. In 2 Timothy 3:16, it says that all scripture is inspired by God, the Greek word theonoustos, God breathed. All scripture is God breathed. Well, what does that mean? What does that look like? It sounds like divine dictation. But it cannot be that way. And the reason being is because Matthew and Luke used sources, right? And Mark he's writing what he remembered Peter telling him. Peter was a source. God is not dictating into Mark's ear what to write down. We notice that there are different education levels. So Paul is more educated than, let's say, Mark was or John was. The author of Hebrews was probably the best communicator of all the New Testament writers. So we can see different educational and skill levels involved with the different New Testament authors. So there's personalities involved. God is not dictating, he has multiple personalities. So how did the divine inspiration process, God breathed, how did that occur? Well, you have 2 Peter chapter 1 that says that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's interpretation, but men moved by the Holy Spirit, carried along by the Holy Spirit, spoke from God. Well, what does that look like? We don't know. So when we say Scripture is divinely inspired, we know that God was behind it. God was behind Scripture being penned, but we don't know exactly how that looks. So in answer to your final question, I would say when I read Scripture and believe that it is divinely inspired, I believe that what is in Scripture is what God intended to be in Scripture, and that I have in Scripture, in my Bible, everything. God has provided everything that I need for salvation and for growth in the Christian life. I can find help here. So that's how I would answer that. I use this book to guide me in my life.
Thank you, Mike. This is Stephen again. And I have one question from the ground, from the floor. Send a text in, and it's the question is about the gospel. With regards to, are they more than just those four gospels? Surely they should be more than four of those records. At the same time, as a follow-up question, mine would be, what about the gospel according to Thomas and among others? Of course, we who study, we understand those are Gnostics in nature. But here in our church, not many of us understand that and what that means. Could you elaborate on those four additional four gospels if they have? And what about those gospels like Thomas and others?
Sure. Well, those other gospels come from the second century and the third. So like the gospel of the Egyptians, the gospel of Mary, the gospel of Philip, third century. You've got the gospel of Thomas. Now scholars debate on when that was written. You have some scholars who put it at the end of the first century, but most scholars place the gospel of Thomas in the middle of the second century and been placed in it toward the end of the second century. I tend to think that it was written toward the end of the second century. There was a scholar in the 1990s, his name's Nicholas Perrin, and he did his doctoral dissertation. It was a brilliant doctoral dissertation. And he was able to do, he discovered that if you translate, and are is mainly written in Coptic, in Egyptian language. If we've got some manuscripts with it in Greek that are earlier. So he thought, okay, well, what if I took the Coptic and translated it back into Greek? Does that make sense? Don't see anything special about it if you do that. And then he tried a couple different languages like Aramaic and all. Well, what he found was that if you translate it back into Syriac, then there's a lot of what he calls catch terms. These are like puns. So like one verse ends with fire, the next verse ends with light. So fire and light and warmth, they're all kind of related. And so you can connect just about every verse in the Gospel of Thomas this way with these catch words, these links originally in Syriac. So then you look at it, if it's translated in Syriac, and it looks a whole lot like the Diatessaron written by Tatian around the year 180. And so Nick Perrin argues that rather than using a lot of the Gospels, the Gospel of Thomas was familiar with the Diatessaron, which was familiar with all four Gospels. And so therefore, the Gospel of Thomas is dated after the year 170, 180. I think it's a pretty good argument, and I've looked at how others who want to date it very early, like at the end of the first century, I want to see how they answer it, and they don't have any good answers to it. So the reason these other Gospels aren't in our New Testaments is because they're too late. They're not written by eyewitnesses. They're not written by those who knew the eyewitnesses or the apostles. They're written too long afterward, second and third century. And the early church never included them in there. Not any of them.
Thank you, Mike. We really appreciate your time with us this morning. And we want to say thank you. Let's everyone give him a wave where he can see. Oh, yeah. Great. And again, we will see you at the second service later on as well. Have a
thank you.
Good evening to you. And again, I hope that everyone's blessed by this evening. This morning here. He has mentioned a lot of things, and most of you might be like, wow, there's too many information. What am I going to do with that? You can ask Reverend Johnny. All right. You can ask him what Septuagint mean and what the Masoretic texts are.